Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wal ladhina jahadu fina lanahdiyannahum subulana. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. So last time we finished talking about the event of the ifk, or the slander against our mother Aisha radiallahu anha. And so the next big event is going to be one of the more pivotal battles. But before we talk about that, just one thing that I wanted to mention with regard to what happened to Aisha radiallahu anha. At the very end, when she was sitting and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was there, and Abu Bakr was there, and her mother was there, and neither did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speak on her behalf, or Abu Bakr, or her mother. And Aisha basically then, she just turned aside and put her back toward the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and her parents, and just said, "I'm just going to wait then. You know, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of things." And that's when the wahi came down. What the ulama explain is that Aisha radiallahu anha, in that time, she basically went into a state, like a spiritual state, where she was overwhelmed with the reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all she saw. Essentially, at that point, she was blind to everything else around her. Pure tawakkul. Because the reality is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only truth that's out there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself is the true eternal. And if you think about it, in her situation, weeks had gone by. Rumors are spreading. She was already sick in the first place. Her husband is not saying anything, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Her own, where else is she going to turn? And a person realizes in that time that it's only Allah. Allah is the only one that you can always rely on, that you can always trust in, that you can always have faith that He is watching over you. Anybody else, no matter how much they care, you tell me that the mother watching her child with some illness or a cancer, doesn't she would give everything in the world to save that child from even one moment of pain. Sometimes she can do it, sometimes she can't do it. So even our own parents, our everybody, at some point or another, they're limited in what they can do. Even the Prophet ﷺ, although he had desire that his own uncle accept Islam, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls these things. So Aisha radiallahu, in that time, that's all she was seeing. So turning her back or not, nobody was there to her. She didn't turn her back, there was no one in the room. What's the big deal? You turned your back. Otherwise, turning your back to the Prophet ﷺ is a breach of adab, it's inappropriate to do. But she wasn't seeing any of that at that point in time. She had just resigned herself 100% in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now obviously she went into that state because of the situation that was around her. But the job of the Muslim, of the mu'min, is to try and inculcate that state, so that they're constantly walking in that sense that Allah is watching over me. Allah will take care of me. Nothing can harm me. Nothing can come to me. Except that Allah wants it to. Except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the true tawakkul. Now that doesn't mean that we negate the sabab. Right? We have. You go to the doctor. You get sick, you go to the doctor. But there are some people who have such tawakkul that you say to them, go to the doctor, and they say, why? So he can give me a sugar pill? Right, that some company spent millions of dollars on, so he's going to give me some placebo. He laughs in your face. My teachers were like that. They would get sick and I'd see them and, you know, coming from the Western mentality, let me take you to the doctor, I know this good doctor, I know. They'd just start laughing. The doctor's going to give me some pill, he's going to take all my money, what am I going to do? He would just say, Bismillah, and take a sip of water. He'd say, Bismillah, and use the miswak and say, Allah will do what Allah's going to do. So some people get that state in them. So Aisha radiallahu anha was basically in that state. All she saw at that moment was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, that's where her focus was. And then we see what happened when somebody has that type of true tawakkul, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave them in that state for very long. Then He shows them what happens when you have that right away on the spot, the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes down. So moving on, the next big event, remember we're still in the fifth year of Hijrah. So the next big event is the battle of, either called Battle of Khandaq, which means the ditch, or Ahzab, which is the plural of Hizb, which are groups. And the reason why it's called the Battle of Ahzab is that there was any number of different groups that were now going to come together to try and again bring a final blow to Islam, to the Prophet ﷺ. So if you remember back one or two sessions, we talked about one of the Jewish tribes, Banu Nadir, that they had basically broke their treaty with the Prophet ﷺ. They were confronted and essentially they were expelled. And they were allowed, except for their weapons, they were allowed to basically take whatever they could carry. And they, we mentioned, went through Medina with this huge sort of, you know, cavalcade of just goods and everything that they had, emptying even the doors, they say, even the doors of their fortresses, they took off and they took with them. Obviously, they had left their, basically their business, I mean, their agriculture behind. I mean, all the money that they left with, as much as it was, that was going to go down at some point. Because the source of the money was left behind. And that was the crops in the fields. And you remember, that's how they were enticed to essentially come up and give up. So, one of their leaders, Huyay, he just had this in his mind that, you know, I'm going to get it back. I mean, he just, you know, he left, obviously he had no other choice, but in his heart, he couldn't leave behind all the orchards and all the wealth that would come from that every year. So he still had this in his heart that I'm going to take it back. And many of these Jews had settled up in Khaybar, which is a little bit north of Medina, so they weren't very far away. And they were allowed to stay there. The Prophet ﷺ allowed them to settle in that area. It was outside of Medina, and it's, you know, essentially far enough away that they weren't much of a threat. So what he does is he goes to Makkah, and he goes to the Quraysh. Now we had seen already in Badr and then Uhud and then Badr number 2, the sort of mini Badr that nothing really happened with it, this was the Quraysh on their own coming after the Muslims. So after what had happened in Uhud and the drought that they had, they weren't yet in a state to attack again. But this Huyay goes to them and basically says, you know, we'll get this tribe, we'll get this tribe, we're ready, we'll get the other Banu Khurayza, we'll get them as well, and basically let's finish them off. Right? They had Badr, but look at Uhud. That went our way. Now like the tide is sort of with us, let's make our move. So Abu Sufyan agrees. But he's still a little bit reluctant. So he asks them a very interesting question. And he says that you are people of the book. Right? You are people of God. You are people of tradition. So you tell us, are we on haq or are the Muslims on haq? These people don't believe in one God. This is the whole fight, right? That we believe in idols and multiple gods in one. How can there be one? So they turn to somebody who believes in what? One God. They believe in one God and ask them, are we right or are the Muslims right? So one, the mentality that these people had. And here we automatically see the response that the Jews are going to give from Banu Nadir is indicating toward their treachery, which is they say, no, you're right. Although it is the way of all of the people of tradition to believe in one. So we have Ahl Kitab. Why do we have that special relationship with the Christians and with the Jews? It is because of that belief, even though they've adulterated that belief today. Still, those are the Christians of today who believe in three, Ahl Kitab. The Jew who believes in one, Ahl Kitab. The Catholic who believes in one, Ahl Kitab. It doesn't matter. That core tenet is there and it binds the religions together, right? We're the three monotheistic religions. So what the Jews should have said is no. I mean, if you're asking, you want to be, we should still get rid of them, but no, obviously we don't agree with you. So anyways, why would the Quraysh themselves even trust these people in that type of a thing? And then the Jews, again, betray their own tradition, right? They betray their own tradition by saying, no, you are definitely closer to Haq, you are closer to right, and so now let's move out together. So they begin to gather an army, and they end up getting one of the tribes, which was by the name of Ghatafan. These people are basically warriors for hire. That's it. They're in it for the money. But they come with 6,000 strong. So they're going to make up a bulk of the army. The Quraysh themselves weren't all that many in this army. So between the Quraysh, between Banu Nadir, between the Ghatafan, and maybe 5-6 other tribes, all of whom came together, they amassed an army of 10,000. So this is way beyond what the Muslims have ever seen or ever faced. And quite possibly in the Arabian Peninsula, up until that time, this is possibly the largest army that was ever assembled. So 10,000, a mix from all of these different tribes that were coming together. Now, like we said, Ghatafan were basically warriors for hire. And so the way they agreed is they were promised that they would get the date harvest of the Jews. That was basically going to be. And again, this was the big treasure of Medina. This was the sort of manufacturing or whatever that came out. You know, every area is known for something. So Medina was known for its dates. So in exchange for the date harvest of the Jews, they agreed to fight. So 6,000 of them coming together. The Muslims had, sit down. The Muslims had 3,000. Okay, the Muslims had 3,000 on their side. So they are outnumbered by more than 3-1. And then again, when you add in the armaments and the camels and the horses and all that, it becomes more than that. But it's basically 10,000 against 3,000. The Muslims receive word that this army is marching, and they basically have 6 days. That's about how much time they have to do whatever they're going to do. If they're going to go out, then go out. If they're going to stay in, to fortify, to figure out whatever their strategy is. So like we've been seeing over and over again, that the Prophet ﷺ, he takes mashura with the Sahaba. He doesn't ask everybody. And this is one of the sunnahs of mashwara that we haven't mentioned specifically, but if you've seen it coming over and over again, the Prophet ﷺ does not treat this like a democracy. Right? So it's not treated like a democracy, let's ask everybody and get a vote. That is not the sunnah of mashwara. You ask the relevant parties. That's the sunnah. So obviously you have to know who those relevant parties are, but to simply say, everybody come and give your opinion, that's a foolish man's walk. Because everybody's going to come with their own foolish opinions. Not everybody is, you know, able to give an opinion depending on what the situation is. You ask the appropriate people. So the Prophet ﷺ gathers the senior amongst the Sahaba so that they can take mashwara. Salman al-Farisi comes and he says that, Ya Rasulullah, you know, where I'm from in Persia, we've come up against armies where they had a lot of cavalry. Right? And again, cavalry is the big issue. We talked in Uhud how the decision was made to stave off the cavalry. Right? Cavalry is extremely, extremely detrimental when you're fighting, especially on open fields. So this was again one of the big worries, because the Quraysh had a lot of the horsemen. Khalid bin Walid is still with them, Ikrimah is still with them, and they're going to be leading the cavalry. So they have not only the horses, but they have the masters of the horses leading them. So how are we going to defend against the cavalry coming in? So what Salman says is, what we used to do is we would dig trenches. This is unheard of in the Arabian Peninsula to do this. They've never seen this being used before. So they take mashwara, and the Prophet ﷺ decides that this is the right thing. So one, we're not going to go out, we're going to stay. And remember, the Prophet ﷺ, for Uhud, that was his primary decision, was that we would stay in. Then when it was opened up, eventually the decision came that we would go out. So now the decision is made, we're going to stay in. And the way that we will defend Medina is we will basically dig this trench. And that will stop. Otherwise, when you have 10,000 people rushing into the city, it's going to be very, very difficult. One, to protect the women and the children and the property and the livestock and everything, and then let alone the fight that's going to ensue when you're full on 3-1. Right? And you have to remember again, even in Uhud, it wasn't a full on battle force against force. Right? They were able to restrict the movements of the army to bring things in the favor of the Muslims. So the Prophet ﷺ himself comes out and he starts marking the areas. Now, Medina wasn't obviously as big as it was today, but it was still a fairly big city. And there's no way that you could build a proper trench around the entire city in 6 days. It would be impossible. But they didn't need that. Because if you remember back to when we talked about the hijrah and the indications to the Prophet ﷺ about where he was going to go, it was between two rocky tracks. So on the east and on the west was this basically volcanic rock, which was very bumpy, so difficult to cross over, and it was sharp. So these lava tracks that were there, so all the way up and down on the left and the right side, the east and the west side, the Muslims were safe. From the south is where the farms and the date palms were. And Banu Qurayza was there, and they still had their truce with the Muslims. So it's also, again, with the horses to come up quick through farms and farmland and trees, and you can't do it. And then Banu Qurayza is there also to protect the backside. So it's just the north side of Medina that's going to be difficult. And that also means that the Quraysh have to come all the way past the south, come up around, and then come back down, right? Because Mecca is south of Medina. So that is where the Prophet ﷺ assigns basically portions. And what he did is he took groups of 10 of the Sahaba, and he assigned them 40 feet that they were each responsible for. So 10 men over here, 10 men over here, 10 men over here, 10 men over here, and he basically spread it as long as he needed so that you were covering now from lava track to lava track. Okay, so there wasn't going to be any opening where the army could make a strong crossing into. Now obviously, if you have horses coming, not only does the trench need to be wide enough that a man can't jump it, it also needs to be wide enough that a horse can't jump it. So an average healthy man can probably jump, you know, I mean, from here to here would be what, maybe 6 feet, right? Two saf is about 6 feet. Average, you know, healthy person can easily jump 6 feet, right? Get a running start and go. A horse probably a bit more. So this was at least 10 to 15 feet wide that it had to be. And it had to be deep enough that it's not just 1 foot in, 1 foot out. Otherwise, what's the point, right? So you can imagine it has to be, what, at least, let's say 5 feet. At a minimum, it would have to be 5 feet deep for the horses. If it's a man, you'd want it to be even deeper, right? And there is always that possibility. Fine, leave the horses, 10,000 men rushing through. So we're talking about something 5 to 10 feet deep and at least 10 feet wide and covering a stretch of at least a couple miles. This is the task that's in front of them in 6 days, in winter, in Medina, in poverty. Right? This is the task in front of the Muslims. So they set out to it. And the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is at the forefront of the task. He's digging with them. The hadith mentions that his whole chest was covered with dust. So he's in the trench like everybody else digging. They're singing along, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be at the end adding in words and giving them. And they're having a very hard time, no doubt about it, but they're doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so they're making the most of the situation. It's wintertime in Medina. Anybody who's been to Medina or been in the desert in the wintertime knows it gets very, very cold. And when the wind goes, especially, they don't have all this thermal that we have and all these fancy fabrics. And, you know, you had wool, which was very heavy and difficult to work in, or you had something thinner, which was easy to work in but wasn't going to keep you warm. And 6 days and the amount of effort, I mean, just think about it, this is nonstop work. I mean, there cannot be any breaks. Or because even one gap, and everybody will just cross over that gap. So there cannot be any area of weakness. So they're working and they're working. The hunger is getting very, very bad. And the fear is also getting very, very bad because 10,000 people are marching on you. And this is something that, except for Salman, nobody's ever seen this thing before. Nobody even knows sort of the logistics of it. And you're so tired, you're so hungry, you don't even know what you're doing, you're just doing it. Just hoping that it's going to work somehow or another. He's the only one. And he was also at the forefront of the digging. And every group of 10, when they saw how much he was into it, was saying, Salman is with us, Salman is with us, Salman is with us, until the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Salman is with me. But that's how much effort that they were putting in. Basically, every able-bodied man was working. So as they're digging, now they come to a problem, which is there's this one huge boulder that they can't break. And again, right, if there's a boulder in the middle, you could just use that as a stepping stone. So this is the one area of weakness. The Sahaba are getting worried. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes. He takes the pickaxe and he takes one huge swing into it. Right? And the Anbiya had the strength of at least 40 men. At least 40 men the Anbiya had the strength of. So he takes one huge whack into it. It doesn't break, a little bit comes off, but this lightning bolt flashes out that everybody saw, including the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everybody yells out, Allahu Akbar. The Prophet again sallallahu alaihi wasallam swings a second time, hits it, another spark comes out, everybody screams, Allahu Akbar. The third time he hits it and it crumbles to dust, the spark comes out, everybody screams out again, Allahu Akbar. And then the Sahaba asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that, what were you saying, what was the light that we saw? And he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam that in the first strike, I saw the red palaces of Syria, of Sham, that the Romans had. I saw that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened those up for us. And in the second strike, I saw the white palaces of Persia, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened it up for us. And in the third strike, I saw the gates of Sana'a in Yemen, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, basically the three big powers of the time. The Muslims are there looking at death, hungry, tired, cold, afraid. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, I'm seeing Rome is being opened up to you, Syria, everything that you know is being opened up to you. Of course, the mu'mineen, they get a boost from this, that subhanAllah, look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for us. The munafiqeen go the other way. And they said that we are so scared that we can't even go out to the bathroom at night. They were worried that some of the enemy is going to be waiting and they're going to pick us off. And you're talking about castles here and castles there and Yemen, and what kind of thing is this? The typical reaction of the disbeliever, that when he hears about something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't make sense. Because all he's looking at is the dunya around him. And from a dunya point of view, how can that happen? It doesn't make any sense. Although from a dunya point of view, how can one man break a boulder that Abu Bakr, you know, Umar was trying, I mean, right, the big of the Sahaba were trying, nobody could, they didn't look at that part of it. But then they're looking at this part of it too. So they're half, you know, 1 foot in the dunya and 1 foot in their nifaq basically, and the darkness that comes with it. And what this teaches us is that you always focus on the end goal. Right? There will certainly be times when things look difficult. Right? In front of us, things look difficult. How are we going to do it? How are we going to do it? But this deen has been promised victory. It wasn't promised victory next week or next month. Maybe so. We don't know. But it was promised victory, which means everything that we're doing, you have to view as a mini battle. And sometimes you lose a battle to win the war. That's just how it goes. Sometimes you give up territory over here so you can make greater gains over here. So we don't know. We may be part of that smaller battle that's going to be a victory, like Badr, or we might be part of that smaller battle that's going to be a loss, like Uhud. Nobody knows. But we do know where the end of the battle is going to be, and that is the side of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is where this thing is headed. And that is what was the reminder to the Sahaba, that don't focus right where we are. Stuck in this ditch, in the dark of Medina, hungry and scared. Look at the greater picture. That you are working for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a plan, and everybody is in a place in that plan. Every one of us is playing a role, sitting here today. This is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us in the grand scheme of how things are going to go. Ammar bin Yasir, he's also digging and digging. And this is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about him that you will be killed by the aggressing party. And probably he thought that that meant he was going to lose his life in this battle. Right? But if we continue on with history, Ammar was actually killed by the army of Muawiyah. And this is one of the proofs that's used by the ulama who say that when Ali and Muawiyah were fighting one another during his khilafah, that he was on the side of Haqq. Because Ammar bin Yasir was with the army of Ali, and he was killed by the aggressing army, like the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like we said, extreme hunger. Abu Bakr, Umar, right, two of the stalwarts of the Sahaba, they come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam having a very, very difficult time. The hunger is just getting too much, and then on top of that, the cold, and then on top of that, the digging. And they're saying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they make dua for us, we're having a hard time, and they lift up their shirts, and you see the rock tied to their stomach. Right? And this is the same, you know, like these... you hear with these lap band surgeries and different things that they do, right? It's the same idea that if you can constrict the stomach, then it makes it easier to deal with those pains that will come from there. So they come, each of them, showing the Prophet ﷺ that they have one of these stones tied. The Prophet ﷺ lifts up his shirt, two stones are tied. Whatever he did, whatever he asked his ummah to do, he was foremost in it. Foremost in it. And then he would ask somebody else to do it. Otherwise, he would never, ﷺ, put anybody in that position. You know, and that's such a beautiful example that we have. Right? And this is the whole idea that a prophet being sent as opposed to an angel, right? Where there's always that distance between us. You know, they don't sleep, they don't drink, they don't eat, they don't get married. No. Look at our example, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He got married. He had children. He had wives. He had to help out in the house. Everything. I mean, everything that we find, your work is sitting in front of a computer, he had his own work. Everybody had the things that they have to do. He lived that exact same life like we did. And yet he still found time to help the people around him and take care of the poor and take care of his family and find time for ibadah, although he was the busiest man that ever lived, right? Arguably the busiest man that ever lived in the history of the world. And the Prophet ﷺ was doing it. Anas radiallahu anhu mentions that during this time that all they had to eat was the leftover fat from animals that had already gone bad. But they were so hungry that they couldn't even swallow it. Right? Not like cooked warm fat, which we even couldn't. I mean, somebody gives you a chunk of the fat, you wouldn't be able to. But at least if it's cooked, it's warm, it slides down your throat. This is the cold, rotten, and he said that we would gag when we would eat it. But that's all we had. And they would, you need some, you know, you got to dig a trench 3 miles across and this much, you need energy. So they would make do. And this is what they were living off during that time. So there's a very interesting hadith that comes, that happened during this incident. Again, we mentioned last time the hadith with Jabir radiallahu anhu, and it's another beautiful hadith with Jabir involved, where in his home, they had a little bit of barley, right? So they could make a little bit of bread basically, and they had a very young goat. Small, you know, and anybody who's seen the little, you can just pick them up, I mean, and there's very little meat, you know, on those animals. You know, you would normally keep it, let it grow a bit, and you'd get much more out of it. Times were difficult. So Jabir's wife, right, remember this somewhat older than him, wiser woman, says that, look, we have this food, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam must be, if we're hungry, he must be hungry. They even knew it, that if I'm feeling this much hunger, he's feeling more hunger, go to him, whisper in his ear that we have food for two or three people. then he should come, he should bring one or two people, and then we'll slaughter the animal, we'll cook the bread, and at least he'll get some food in his stomach, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jabir says, of course, goes out to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's on the, you know, digging lines with everybody else, they're singing, the life of the akhirah is the real life, may Allah forgive the muhajireen and the ansar, Allahu Akbar, they're doing dhikr. He whispers in the ear of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that, you know, my wife said we have a small animal, we have a little bit of food, come yourself and bring, you know, two, three people, inshallah you can have a meal and get some energy back. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Jabir, he smiles, and he calls out that, oh, group of the Muslims, Jabir has invited all of you, at least 800 people, all of you to his house for a meal. So come in groups, you know, everybody can't fit, but come 10, 10 by 10, we're going to get some food, inshallah. Jabir said, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." What just happened? My one, you know, this, and my wife's gonna kill me. She said two or three people. So he runs home, and he says that the Prophet is coming, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with everybody. Now again, the wisdom of the woman. She says, "Did he invite everybody, or did you? Because if it was you, you're gonna get it. If it was him, let's not." He says, "No, no, the Prophet did." She said, "Don't worry about it." Right? She herself is calm, and she's calming the Jabir. That don't worry about it. The Prophet comes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he comes into the kitchen area, and he said that he had given word to call 10 of the best bread-making women, right? The ones who could really, you know, get in there and quickly make the bread. So he came into the area where there were the balls of dough, a few of them, and they were covered, you know, you keep them covered with a sheet to keep them moist. And then there was the little pot, like the little cauldron that was cooking with whatever little meat that came off. And the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made a dua, and he said that do not look in the pot and do not lift the sheet off the bread to see how many more balls of dough there are. Just get to work, right? 10 women cooking and just dish out the food. 10 by 10, they came, they ate. They came, they ate. You can imagine after days and days of not having any food, working day and night, 10 by 10 by 10 by 10, 800 people came, ate their fill, went their way, and Jabir said later that when I looked, I couldn't tell if it was the same amount of food or if even a little bit more was there. Not like it was down to that last little, we just made it. Either it was the same, or maybe there was a little bit more food in there. So this is the blessing of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi. And there are other instances as well with food, obviously, that was, you know, able to keep the army. And again, the dhikr, right? The dhikr, because we know that when the Dajjal comes, he will have all of the food. And this is going to be one of the tricks that he's going to, you know, like warehouses maybe, something, or piles of food. And he'll just say, it's all for you, just come with me. Just give me the pledge and take whatever you want. It's all waiting for you guys, right? And this is how he's going to entice people. And the Sahaba asked that, Ya Rasulullah, when those days become like the long days, then how will the people survive? And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on there, Alhamdulillah, and Subhanallah, and La ilaha illallah. That's all that there's going to be. I mean, that is the asal nourishment anyways. Because where does it come from? It comes from Allah. Those 2,000 calories that you ate during the day, you only get the benefit when Allah says, body benefit. So fine, you use the food, you use the dhikr, it's all the same in the end of the day. Obviously the dhikr is what attracts the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, I'm sure we've all had an experience, you ate something, you get sick from it. That food didn't benefit you, right? Because the mercy of Allah didn't come into it. Instead, you're in the bathroom throwing it up, thinking, I'm never having that thing again. That's the last time. Although you thought it was going to be fine, it was cooked properly, everything was there for you. So the dhikr as well of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is keeping them going. Now bad news comes, which is that there's a rumor, at least for now, spreading that Banu Qurayza has broken the treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If it's true, it's horrific news. Because you thought you had one front that you were going to fight on and limit the enemy to, and now all of a sudden the backside opened up. And it puts the Quraysh that much closer, because again, remember, this is the south, and that's the direction they're coming from. So it's going to take even, it means you had even less time than you thought you did, and now, in addition to trying to finish off the trench and defending that line, you are going to have to defend the backside. So this is very, very worrisome. And so the Prophet ﷺ wanted to confirm before he made any sort of announcement or made any decision that did this actually happen. So he sent out a few of the Sahaba, and he told them that go, see what happened. When you come back, if it's good news, tell everybody. Right? If they're holding fast to the treaty, walk through Medina yelling it out. Banu Qurayza is with us, no problem. If it's bad news, don't say anything. Come to me, give me an ishara. Because if you call out that type of bad news, and these guys still have to dig X number of feet and it's just going to crush them. It's going to be too much. So they go out, they meet with Banu Qurayza, and it becomes clear that 100% they broke the treaty. They even ripped up the treaty, the paper that had been signed upon. And you know, sitting in front of them, they made it clear that they said, messenger who? Messenger who? We don't know any messenger. How can we have a treaty with a messenger of Allah? We don't know any messenger of Allah. So they broke the treaty. So when they came back, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, he's working with everybody. I mean, he's not, you know, he's around the people. And they basically said two words. And they mentioned the names. If you remember the incident of Raji'a, the treachery that happened, they mentioned the names of those two tribes, which is an indication of treachery, right? That somebody is breaking their pact with us. So the Prophet realizes right away sallallahu alaihi wasallam what happened. Doesn't tell everybody, but now he needs to change up the game plan a little bit because the south of Medina is not protected anymore. So he has to pull away of their 3,000, he has to pull away a couple hundred men and set them back. And even some of the narrations indicate that later on the women themselves had to come out and fight because that area wasn't being able to be defended as properly as they wanted to. So all the women and children are moved into the forts, and now Medina is basically surrounded. You know, and the Sahaba are getting more and more afraid. And how does the Quran tells us? It says that it's like their hearts had come into their throats. You know, that's the fear. Now, not fear at losing their lives. Not fear that what's going to happen to my wife and my kids. Fear that one, something may happen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And how can I be alive and something happen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And two, that what could this mean for Islam? So this is the fear that overwhelmed the Sahaba. Because they recognize that we are the Ummah. I mean, that's, you know, I mean, you know, Allah save us from ever happening, but if there is some community of Muslims somewhere in the world and they get wiped out, there's other Muslims, you know, who will come and fill the void. This is not the case here. Everybody is basically there. You know, and if there's a blow that's dealt, it's a blow to Islam. And it's a blow against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're very, very worried. The hypocrites, of course, are saying, you guys are talking about this and that and this trench and there's no way. And so they go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they say that, you know, our houses are left unprotected. So we need to go protect. This is their excuse basically to get it. He says, fine. Because he knows, we don't need hypocrites. We don't need the weak people with us. Whatever we're going to do, it's going to be because the mercy of Allah comes. And the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes when the true people are there. The numbers don't matter. He said, go ahead, go to your houses. No problem. Right? No problem, you can go away. So now the numbers get depleted a little bit more, the hypocrites go away. The Quraysh approach. Khalid bin Walid, Ikrimah on the cavalry, obviously cavalry leads the charge. They get a little bit close and they're taken aback. There's this huge gaping hole in front of us. And again, they had never seen this either. Right? So the Arabs weren't used to this. Obviously these people also weren't used to it. And Khalid remarked that this is not from the Arabs. I mean, that much he knew. Right, and he was a master strategist, so he knew all the different, you know, and that's why it wasn't enough to say, you know what, let's go out to Uhud and do the same thing. Right, we'll have the mountain on one side, we'll have here, we'll stand there. You can't repeat, right, because military strategy goes that way. Once you do something one time, they'll figure out a way to get around it. So Khalid recognized and he says that this is not from the Arabs. He knows right away. And so he's surveying and he also realizes that there goes the cavalry. There's no benefit because even if a horse could make the jump, it's going to need a running start. So obviously the Sahaba and the archers amongst them are ready with their arrows, trained. So by the time you start coming, they just start picking you up. And that's the same reason that in Uhud, as long as the archers remained, they were safe. And they didn't even try and make an attack because they would just, by the time you got to them, they would have picked you off. Right? And you know, it's essentially, the archers of the day were like the machine guns of today. I mean, they were quick and they were accurate. And just one by one, they would just pick you off. So Khalid right away realizes that there's nothing that can happen. So basically all that amounts so far in the battle is exchange of arrows. So there's exchange of arrows going back and forth. Now, what makes it difficult for the Sahaba is that even though the cavalry can't approach and they have this trench, the trench is not such that you can just walk away and go to sleep. They'll just climb down and they'll climb up. The horses may not be able to get through, but 10,000 men are there. And they'll just, you know, five guys will jump in and they'll just keep helping people over. So 24/7, every inch of the trench has to be manned and has to be washed and has to be guarded. So already after 6 days of basically nonstop work, very, very little sleep, hunger, cold, the physical exertion, now for any number of days, they have to keep it up. Right? Remember now again, a couple hundred are sent to the south to take care of that side of things. So it's getting very, very difficult. There was one area of the trench that was a little bit more shallow. So Ikrimah and one or two others were able to get their horses by really pushing the horse to make the jump, right? It wasn't an amount that normally a horse could do, but you know, horsemen know how to push their animals. They made the jump over. One of the ones who went with him was this one of the Quraysh's named Amr. He was one of their foremost warriors and built like a warrior. He was very, very large, and he had taken out any number of people in all the great battles of the past. It was known about him that if a Qurayshi ever gave him one of two offers, he would pick one of them. So if he ever said A or B, right? Out of his rahmah, essentially, right? A Qurayshi is asking me, I'll take one or two of them. You want tea or coffee? I'll take tea, right? Whatever it's going to be. So Ali radiallahu an, right? Now remember, Ali is extremely brave, and he's a ferocious fighter, but he's not built like a fighter. He doesn't have that stature of like Hamza radiallahu an or Umar. So he steps up. Amr recognizes him because Amr was friends with Abu Talib, so the father of Ali. So Ali says that I've heard about you that if a Qurayshi ever gives you two offers, you'll always take one of them. He says, yeah. So he says, I'm giving you the first offer. The first offer is La ilaha illallah. He says, I have no need for La ilaha illallah. He says, the second offer is my sword. And he looks at him and he says that I would feel ashamed spilling your blood. You know, you're a little young guy. You know, I knew your father. Send a man. You know, you're going to send somebody, send a man. He said, I feel ashamed shedding your blood. And Ali says, I'm more than happy to shed yours. And that just, it gets him angry. So he rushes at Ali and he comes down full force with his sword. And Ali radiallahu anhu puts up his shield, and the force is so much that the shield gets knocked into his head. And it's so hard that the sword gets stuck in the shield. So now Amr is basically undefended, so Ali sort of regains himself and he takes off his head and he knocks him down. And this, morally speaking, also deals a huge blow to the Quraysh. They finally manage to get across. Ikrimah is there, Amr is there, one of their greatest warriors. They know a little bit about Ali, but still he's this little person to them. He's still relatively young during this time. And to have him take out one of their foremost, it just sort of, so the others then retreat back over. But again, the fighting now is a little bit fierce in the sense that you're shooting the arrows and you're constantly watching. And it got so fierce at some point that the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba actually missed Asr Salah. Because again, you had to constantly guard the entire length of the trench or they would come through. So they missed their Asr Salah during this time as well. This is now going on for days. Yes, so remember, 6 days of extremely strenuous work, and now basically no sleep, fear, hunger, cold, everything is continuing on for days and days and days. Weeks begin to pass. The Prophet ﷺ is seeing the condition of the Sahaba, and they're having a hard time. Right? They're withholding, they're doing what they have to do, but they're having a very difficult time. So he decides that I will try and make a deal with Ghatafan. So remember, Ghatafan is these mercenaries for hire. Right? 6,000 out of the 10,000 are from them. So that's, you know, otherwise there's 3,000 Muslims, that's going to basically level the playing field. So he sends out a letter to Ghatafan saying that let's negotiate, let's talk. You're not here because you care about Islam or don't care about Islam, you're here for money. We will give you, Medina has dates, we will give you 1/3 of our take from the dates. And basically go home. Right? No loss to you. You already got paid from their side, get paid from our side, you leave. We don't have any issue with you. So they do some haggling, they agree finally on the 1/3, the contract is written up and sent to the Prophet ﷺ for final approval. Now there's a problem. The dates aren't his ﷺ. Right? He doesn't own Medina. Right? He's not like a king. He doesn't own Medina and he doesn't act like he owns Medina. He knows that of these date palms, actually not a single one of them was the Prophet ﷺ. That's why he was tying two stones to it. I mean, he had nothing, right? He wouldn't go to sleep if there was anything in the house. So he had to ask the people who it belonged to, right? Which were the Sahaba, and in particular, the Ansar. So he calls Sa'd bin Mu'ad and Sa'd bin Ubadah, right? The two heads of the Aws and the Khazraj. And he takes mashra with them. Again, right? Not with everybody, with the ones who it's most pertinent to. He calls them and he takes mashra. And he says, look, you know, I see everybody's state. I see what's happening. I've made this arrangement with the Ghatafan, we give them 1/3, and then they'll walk away, and inshallah that will, you know, he didn't know that that would end the war necessarily, but that will at least ease the situation a little bit. So they asked the Prophet ﷺ first, that is this wahi or not? Right? Are you doing this because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you, or are you doing it because of us? And they knew. I mean, they knew the suffering that they were feeling, and they see it all around them and within themselves as well. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that it's not from wahi. Right? It's not from wahi. He sort of says it in a very nice way. It's not meaning it's because of you guys. I mean, I'm watching you guys, and it's too much. You know, it's taking too much of a toll on you. And so they say to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that, you know, before we accepted Islam, if those same people from Ghatafan had ever come into Medina asking for anything, demanding anything from us, they would have not have even gotten one single date. How can it be that now we accept Islam, now we're on haq, and they come and we give them one third of our crops? He said, they'll never get anything from us. And so the Prophet wipes off the contract, and he says that we'll keep fighting them until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides. Right? So this is an opportunity, one, for the Ansar to show who they are. And also, perhaps, maybe the Prophet ﷺ was testing their resolve to see. Right? And again, he would never burden somebody with more than they can handle. And how many things that come in the ahadith, if it wasn't a burden on my ummah, I would have A, B, C, and D. Any number of different things. If it wasn't a burden, if it wasn't a burden, if it wasn't a burden. And the ulama explain that any time those types of narrations came, if the sahaba stayed silent, that thing did not become mandatory. If the sahaba said, no, we're fine with it, then it got part of the sharia. Right? So for example, the miswak and some of these other different types of things. So now they're back to where they started, right? Sitting in, under siege, weeks and weeks going by, hungry, everything. Sa'd bin Mu'adh, one of the ones who was instrumental in this last event, he also, during some of the skirmishes with the arrows, he had gotten hit in the arm, and it hit an artery. So there was a lot of bleeding that was happening. They didn't have hospitals and all these surgeries and things that we're used to today. So it was becoming clear that this was going to be a death blow for him. You know, he's losing a lot of blood, he's getting weak, so he's pulled back. They made a makeshift hospital in the masjid, where they could take care of, and the women basically were then tending to any of the wounded. Now something amazing happens. One of the people of Ghatafan, his name was Nu'aym, seeing 10,000 against 3,000, the Muslims are hungry, they're cold, they're afraid, what happens to him? Iman enters his heart. Of all the times to accept Islam, I mean, this is like death in the eyes of the mu'mineen, and something happens, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the iman in his heart. And so he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sneaks across the lines, comes into enemy territory, right, and basically goes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says that Allah put iman in my heart. So what do you want me to do? Right? Now I'm at your service, basically. And the Prophet says to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you're one person, what are you going to do? Right? Well, you're going to join the army? We have 3,000, you're just going to be like us. At least go over there, you were eating. You know, you had a fire, you had some warmth, right? And he says, but I'm very well liked amongst my people. And so the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, go back. Don't tell anybody you accepted Islam. Go back to your people and do whatever you can to help us. That's it. He doesn't give him a plan. He doesn't say, okay, here's the great idea and you're going to... He says, I don't know, but go back and do whatever you can. And then Nu'aym asks them, that he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that can I lie? Because obviously, I mean, now he's a Muslim, so one, he has to lie about his Islam. He's going to want to pray, so they might, you know, so he's, can I lie? And the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that war is deception. And basically giving him permission that this is the nature of war, that you will have to use some deceit. So go back and do whatever you can in order to benefit the Muslims. So he goes back. Now again, he has good relations with everybody. So he's from Ghatafan, right? That's the 6,000 strong. He has good relations with the Quraysh. He also has good relations with Banu Qurayza. So first he goes to Banu Qurayza, and he tells them that, look, Banu Nadir, they were just like you, a Jewish tribe. They had a pact with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They broke it. Look what happened to them. They lost their land. They're living over there. They have nothing. You are not like the Quraysh in Ghatafan. They are coming from other areas. If the tide turns on them in this battle, what are they going to do? They're just going to go back home. That's it. They're just going to go back to Mecca, they're going to go back to the outskirts, and maybe they lose 10, 20 men, and they're going to live their life. You are going to end up like Banu Nadir. You're going to lose everything, and you're going to lose your home. And they start thinking, you know, that's true. I mean, we're not all in this in the same way. You know, and we are the ones who had a pact that we broke. So we are in a very precarious position. So what he says is that if these people leave you, you're going to be all alone. So what you need to do, and you know, they're also, obviously the Quraysh also, they came thinking it's going to be a battle, we're going to win, we're going to go. They had no idea it was going to get extended for this. They do have supplies, but they're starting to dwindle as well. So he says to them, Nu'aym, that you know what? You need to make sure that they're in this to the end. That's the only way it's worth it for you. So you need to tell them that, you know, we're not 100% sure of your commitment. Obviously, our stake in this is slightly greater than yours. We have nowhere else to go. It's our homes. We want you to give, as like a collateral, right? As a security deposit, 100 of your men. And once we're done, then you'll take them back. And that way we know you're in this 100%, right? Because we have the most to lose in this situation. So that's what he tells them to do. And, you know, they take him to heart, right? And then this is one of their, you know, friends, one of their good people. Then he goes to the Quraysh. And he says, you know, I love you guys and you're this and you're that. But you know what? I got wind of something. Don't tell anybody. Right? The same thing he says to the people of Quraydah. I'm going to tell you something, but don't tell anybody. I'm going to tell you something, don't tell anybody. I think Banu Quraydah has made a deal with the Prophet ﷺ. They're afraid. You guys have your homes. They're worried about losing everything. They had a pact. They broke it. They saw what happened to Banu Nadir. So they made a deal with the Prophet ﷺ. And in order to show that they're going to be true to the deal, it was that they're going to give 100 of your men to the Prophet ﷺ. He can execute them, and that's going to prove their sincerity and the reaffirming of the pact that they had in the first place. So they say, wait, whoa, this is very problematic. You know, these people, we never should have trusted them in the first place, and this and that, and they go into this whole different thing. So now they're all worried. And then he goes to Ghatafan and he does the same thing like he did with the Quraysh. That basically the people of Quraydah, I've heard they made a deal. They agreed they're going to give 100 of your men to the Prophet ﷺ. So now again, nobody had planned for this long siege. So Ikrimah comes and he says, look, you know, we didn't come for this. Our supplies are dwindling. Morale is beginning to drop. We have 10,000 people. We need an all-out assault. Everybody will try and cross, the men will go in the ditches, the arrows will be fired, we'll overrun them. I mean, how can they withstand 10,000 people, you know, breaking upon them? So let's get ready for that final assault, you know, because we cannot just sit here, nothing's going to happen like this. They reply, Banu Quraydah, that look, tomorrow is the Sabbath, we can't fight on the Sabbath, right? The last time that we know that our people of the past broke the Sabbath, really bad things happened to them. And you know what? We need assurances that you're going to stay. Right? You're already pushing and pushing, ready to go. You want it done with. You're not in this to the long run. You know what? Why don't you give us 100 men? Why don't you give us 100 men? And that way we know that you're committed. So boom. Now the Quraysh are thinking, oh, wait a minute. That's exactly what Nu'aym said. Alhamdulillah for Nu'aym. You know, he told us this was going to happen. He's our saving grace. So they say, no way. We're not giving you one man. Now Banu Quraydah, subhanAllah for Nu'aym, he told us that they're not in it for the long run. And so now, amongst the tribes, the seeds of discord begin to get sown. And now everybody is doubting and nobody knows, everybody is tired, they're thinking, what should we do? So then the Prophet ﷺ makes a dua. And he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send out an enemy that will destroy them. Send out some way and finish off our enemy. And so the winds began to pick up. Now you have to understand that these people are living in tents basically. And in the desert, there's nothing to stop the wind from blowing. So when it blows, it really blows. And obviously a tent, you know, unlike our aerodynamic REI tents that push the wind around, but even then, what do you stake them in the ground? Sand doesn't hold stakes that well. And two, they weren't made that way. So they were just going to get big and then they were going to get blown over. So the wind is blowing. It was already cold. Now it's even colder. You know, it's cutting through, like, you know, bone-chilling cold. Tents are being thrown everywhere. And the other part is that you can't see anything. Because it's not just wind, it's sand. And anybody who's ever been in the desert, and one time I remember we were going to Medina, and we were driving, we had arrived into Jeddah, and plans got changed, and we got a car, and so we were driving to Medina, and we hadn't prayed, it was Dhuhr Salah, I think, Dhuhr Asr, one of them. So we stopped on the side of the road. You know, portions between Jeddah and Medina have all those shops, and then there's a long strip where there's really not a whole lot of anything. So we had to stop to pray on the side of the road. And the way that the wind was blowing was as if it was coming on our backs. Right? So we're standing facing the Qibla, facing Makkah, and the wind is coming from our back. And we're praying. And then we go down into sajda. And then you feel it, right? Because now otherwise you're protected. All of a sudden, the minute I got down, just my nose, my mouth filled with sand. And I could barely even breathe. And it wasn't even that, you didn't feel like it was a windy day out there. But you know, there's nothing else except sand. So either it's blowing from here or it's blowing from there. So it's blinding, you can't see anything. The tents are being thrown out, the fires are being blown out, the food that they're cooking is also being knocked over. So things get really, really bad. But the Prophet doesn't know, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what's the result of this. Now again, we're talking weeks into this thing for the Sahaba. It's at night. The wind is blowing. The Prophet calls out to the Sahaba and he says that which one of you will go and give us word of the enemy? And the one who does that, he will be my companion in Jannah. SubhanAllah. Not just in Jannah. Not just disguarded. You will be my companion in Jannah. Who raises their hand? Nobody. Not an Abu Bakr, not an Umar, not an Ali, not an Uthman. You name it, nobody. Because they were just in a state themselves. I mean, can you imagine the hunger and the fear and the cold and it's dark and you want us to go march over to the enemy lines, we can't see anything, they can't see anything. Nobody says anything. The Prophet waits, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who speaks up? Nobody. That's it, nobody's going to say anything. So the Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, Hudhayfa, where are you? And Hudhayfa stands up, shivering. I'm here, Ya Rasulullah, I'm here. He says, oh, I didn't know you were here, why don't you go? Why don't you go and help us out with this task? He says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm ready, no problem, I'm ready. And so he begins, and he mentions that actually the wind felt warm when he started going, that the wind that was hitting him felt warm for him and it warmed his bones, and he got into the enemy encampment. And the Prophet told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that go, scout out, come back, don't do anything. Like, don't cause any trouble, don't let them know you're there, you're just going to reconnaissance basically. That's it. So he goes out and he gets a sense of what's going on, and he mentioned that I saw Abu Sufyan. He's right in front of me. And I could have just taken out my... and I could have just finished him off right then and there. But I remembered the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he just kind of blended in, seeing what was going on. Now Abu Sufyan must have had some feeling or something. He felt like, you know, there could be some spies coming within our midst because we can't even see anything. And everybody then, you know, you bring your cloak and your shawl even more over you and you're trying to stay warm. So he calls out to the people and he says, every man check the man to your side. Then who is he? Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? Who therefore right away, what does he do? He grabs a guy and he's right, who are you? Grabs a guy, who are you? You're not going to ask again, right? So now this guy was already asked, so he basically, using his hikmah, he saves himself from being caught. And then he comes back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is praying. Right? What do you do when times are rough? You're cold, you're hungry, you're afraid? Pray. Right? You pray. So he's praying sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he has a cloak over him, right, to keep himself warm. So he sees Hudhayfa approaching. He's not going to break his salah because he's speaking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he opens up his cloak. So standing in the prayer, he opens up his cloak because poor Hudhayfa is freezing. So he comes inside and he closes the cloak. Can you imagine? I mean, he's huddling by the ankles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he's communing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the cloak, and the Prophet of Allah is just praying, he's praying, he's praying. Finally, when he's done, then he asks Hudhayfa that what was the state of the people. And so he says that, you know, they're in really bad situation, this and that, and they're worried and they're scared, and I think that, you know, this is basically going to be the end of it. And this narration that we find out what Hudhayfa did, and that the reason why this narration came about, it wasn't during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he told this story. One time, one of the tabi'in had come up to him, and he said that, oh, you know, we heard about all the difficulties and all these different things, and this happened, and the jawbone, and the blood, and the, you know, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with us, his feet wouldn't even touch the ground. You know, like we'd be carrying him on our shoulders. I mean, that's how we would have taken care of him. Not even his foot would have had to touch the ground, let alone, you know, maybe whatever things he was potentially insinuating at. And Hudhayfa said, you think it was that easy? And then he told the story. That not a single Sahaba, when the Prophet says, my companion in Jannah, not a single Sahaba stood up. So don't say that we would have, you don't know what it was like over there. And you don't know that you would have been able to keep the iman during that time. We didn't even know. I mean, we couldn't even raise our hand for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is unheard of. We've seen times where on the first call, nobody sort of, and then somebody, right? But we don't see any situations where anyone, you know, and nobody. And the Prophet himself has to pick out sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? This is extremely rare to see this situation. So never feel like, oh, if I was around during that time, I would have done this, and I never would have done that, and I would have said, oh, we should stay in Medina. It's never like that. You know, until you are in that situation, you never know how you would have reacted. So basically, the next morning, Abu Sufyan's had enough. And he basically says, I'm leaving, everybody should just go. You know what, I mean, our tents are gone, our fires are gone, we've been here for how long, this is not going anywhere. Banu Qurayda is saying, give us 100 men, I'm leaving, and you guys basically, you should get up and go too. And Khalid bin Walid goes to him and says, you know, you're the captain of the ship, at least let the people leave in front of you. I mean, don't be so cowardly that you're the first one out of the, when the boat is going down. So he waits a little bit, people start to leave, and then he goes as well. Khalid stays back with the cavalry to cover the flank, right, in case the Muslims have any idea. And you know, they probably didn't realize how bad their shape was, right? Because you know, you put on that show, right? Like when the you know, we'll get to it eventually, when the Muslims finally get to go to the Kaaba. You know, and that's one thing that, you know, we've been talking about 5 years, there's no Kaaba anymore. I mean, imagine how heartbroken the Sahaba must have been at that one fact that we haven't seen the Kaaba in so long. Right? We haven't been mentioning the Kaaba. Right? It used to be they were in front of the Kaaba, this happened. The Quraysh were in front of the Kaaba, this happened. The Prophet was doing, everything was about the Kaaba for 5 years now, nothing. Right? But in their hearts that was, you know, burning for them. So, you know, Khalid bin Walid stays back to cover the flank. As soon as everybody else is gone then he, you know, takes everybody back. And he recognized, and he mentioned later that, you know, I recognized then that something special happened. Right? So you can see the cracks coming, you know, because this was not some, I mean, 10,000 people, all the tribes coming together, this should have been a slaughter. And not only was it not a, there wasn't even a battle really. I mean, there was those few skirmishes, there was the salah that was missed, there was the arrows being shot, there were a few casualties, but there really wasn't even a battle in days and days and weeks of what happened throughout this entire thing. So then the Prophet ﷺ gives out word to the Sahaba that the Quraysh have gone, you guys can go back. And then he realizes, well, what if they turn around? Right, so we better stay back. So then he calls back and he says, no, some of you need to come and stay. Nobody listened. They all just kept walking. He says, go ahead, that's okay. Don't worry about it. I know it's been enough. Inshallah, they're not going to come again. Right? I mean, that's how, you know, difficult this time was for the Sahaba, that they, you know, they themselves, I mean, they were so happy when the word came that the Quraysh had taken off. And then the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that this is the turning tide. That from now on, they will not wage war on us, we will wage war on them. So now the shift is going to come from a defensive position to an offensive position. And we'll see this to hold true. So this really is a big change, but what it reminds us is that, you know, we all know 13 years in Makkah was, we can't even imagine the difficulties that the Muslims faced. Medina wasn't all of a sudden Jannah. The first 5 years, I mean, this is the end of these 5 years, and look at the state of the Muslims. They don't even have food, they're eating rotten fat, you know, at a time when they don't even have that to, you know, feed themselves, basically, right? So this is, you know, now the tide will begin to change very, very quickly. In the next 5 years, you know, things will be able to go very, very quickly and move ahead. So the next thing that we want to cover, inshallah, we'll try and cover it in the little bit of time that we have left, was what to do with Banu Qurayza. Right? So there were the three Jewish tribes originally, they had made contracts, one by one they're gone. Banu Qurayza now. They were clearly treacherous. They were on the side of the enemy, they were fighting against the Muslims. What do we do with them? So the Prophet ﷺ returned back. He prayed Dhuhr with the Sahaba, and then he went home, and he was beginning to take off his turban and his armor and everything that he was wearing. And Jibreel alayhi salam shows up, fully armored, turban on, sword, everything. And he says, what are you doing? You're taking off your armor? You're taking off your weaponry? We're ready to go to Qurayza. Let's get ready, we're marching. And we're coming with you. You're marching and we're coming with you. Right? So the angels are ready as well. So the Prophet ﷺ goes out and he gives the command to the Sahaba that none of you should pray Asr except in Banu Qurayza. Meaning, move it. You know, like right away, because we just prayed the whole time. Banu Qurayza is not that far, but you still have to. You know, it's in Khaybar, it's north of the city. But they're south of the city. They're not Khaybar, they're south of the city. So we have to head out. So the Sahaba right away then, they go home, they also get everything ready. Again, this is just after weeks of difficulty, but the command of the Prophet ﷺ, they have the himmah, they make the effort, and they begin the march. Now the Prophet said ﷺ, none of you should pray Asr except in Banu Qurayza. Along the way, it becomes clear that we are not going to make it in time. That by the time we get to Banu Qurayza, it's going to be Maghrib time. So what do we do? Now the Sahaba have different opinions. One group says that, look, the words in front of us are very clear. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do not pray Asr except in Banu Qurayza. We're going to pray in Banu Qurayza. Whether it's on time or not is irrelevant, right? Because one source of wahi is saying, pray your salah on time. Right? Quran says, salah is mawqut. It's a set time, prescribed times. And one source of wahi is saying, pray it over there. The other sahaba, the other group says, no. Quran is Quran. This is the normal rule. The Prophet ﷺ was simply giving indication that go quick. I mean, don't waste a single moment. I want you to get there and move so fast that you can pray Asr. He didn't mean to make the salah qada. Because, I mean, we just saw that in the battle, Asr was made qada, and that was a very big deal for the Muslims that they couldn't pray on. They prayed later, but to not pray on time, I mean, that's as unheard of for a Muslim, right? To not pray on time. So half of them prayed on the spot before the time ended. The other half said no. And they continued on, and they ended up missing Asr Salah in its time, and they ended up praying it in Banu Qurayza. And when they went to the Prophet ﷺ and said what happened, then he basically confirmed both opinions. And he says, you guys were correcting what you did, and you guys were correcting what you did. And this is one of the best examples that people say, how can there be multiple opinions? Right? How can there be multiple correct opinions? And it also gives you a sense that, imagine, in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, everybody heard the exact same words from his mouth. Everybody knew the verses of Quran, and there's still ikhtilaf. I mean, so much for the people who say we should have one madhab. Everybody should do things one way. It's not going to happen. That was when they were in front of the Prophet ﷺ. People who knew the language, they were from the same tribe, they had, you know, they were all on the same page. Obviously today, when you have weak narrations and strong narrations and all these different things that are going to come, there's going to be differing opinions. And this is one of the best examples to highlight. And it's a proof for ijtihad. That if it's not 100% clear, then you basically apply your reasoning. And that's why some sahaba were very literalist, right? And this is how some of the fuqaha were, very literalist. Right, Imam Ahmad says, one time the Sahaba were sitting together, they were eating, and the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that all of you should go and make wudu. And they were eating camel meat at the time. So Imam Ahmad said, they were eating camel meat, they made wudu, camel meat breaks your wudu. The other Imam said, doesn't really make sense that camel meat will break your wudu, because everything else that breaks your wudu has to do with najasa. So they said that actually this was the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that there were some people who had actually passed gas. And so as not to make them feel ashamed that, oh, you who passed gas, please get up and go and make wudu, he ordered everybody to go and do it. And anyways, for everybody else, it's sunnah that for the salah time you make a fresh wudu. Right? So there are different approaches. One is just take a very literal approach, that's fine as well. Some sahaba did that, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's right. Some said, wait a minute, let's look at it holistically. And they came with a different opinion. So they reach to Banu Qurayza. And they basically surround, right? Banu Qurayza then all went into their fortresses, and they're basically surrounded. And now they're trying to figure out amongst themselves, what do we do? Because they know they broke the treaty, they know they've been treacherous. So they're meeting within one another, and one of their leaders says, look, I see three options. I see three possibilities for what we can do. One is that we leave Judaism, and we accept Islam. And we join the Muslims, and we all live, and we get to keep our homes, we get to keep everything, and there's no problem. And they say, how can we do that? You know, I mean, we're the chosen people. We can't follow a prophet who's not from us. There's no way. An Arab? No way. It's not possible. They reject that idea. Then he says, fine. You don't want that? Then I think that each one of you go home and you kill your wives and your children. And that way, we will be unbarred. Because what do people make bad decisions because of? They're worried about their family. Right? We're worried about, so I have to work this many hours and I have to save up this much money, and oh, it's okay, he's tired, let him sleep through Fajr and whatever it is. Right? We make excuses. So he says that, look, go home, each of you kill your own families, you'll come back, we have nothing to worry about then. We will be able to fight unencumbered. If we win, then we will take the Sahabiya, essentially, as prisoners of war. You can marry some of them, you can have more children. Women come and go, children come and go. And then if you lose, who cares? You have nothing to come back to. Right? You lost anything anyway. They say, no, that's not a good idea either. So they reject that. The third is that tomorrow is the Sabbath. And the Muslims know that we don't do anything on the Sabbath. So we will break the Sabbath and we will fight. And we will get the element of surprise and then we can overtake them. And they say, no. The last time that people, you know, of our faith broke the Sabbath, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned them into monkeys and pigs and disfigured them. There's no way we can do that either. So they're stuck. So then what they do is they ask the Muslims, that can you send us somebody and we can take mashwara with that person? Right? Maybe we'll get some ideas or whatnot. So Abu Lubaba goes. And they ask Abu Lubaba, and they knew him, so they ask him that, what do you think we should do? Because right? Basically the reason why they called somebody is they want to get a sense of what the Muslims are thinking. Because now they have run out of options. So they want to know that if we surrender, are we gonna be set free? Banu Nadir was set free. They got to take everything with them. Maybe that's going to happen to us. So let's get a sense. So Abu Lubaba comes in, and they ask him, what should we do? And he says that, you know, you should surrender. Obviously, I mean, the Muslims are there. You should surrender. What's wrong with you guys? And they say, but then what's going to happen to us if we do that? He doesn't say anything, but he runs his finger across his throat, meaning, off with your heads. And then the minute he did it, he realized, I gave away the secret of the Prophet ﷺ. Why would you do that? If they were ready to surrender, there's no way they're going to surrender. If we think back, when Hudhayfa went, and the Prophet ﷺ said, do not cause anybody to notice you. What would have happened if he had shot an arrow into Abu Sufyan? It would have re-energized the Quraysh. That we let a man take out our leader, no way, they would have stayed, they would have fought. That was the hikmah of the Prophet ﷺ, just go in and come back. Don't give them a reason to fight. And look at what exactly happened here. And right away Abu Lubaba realized it. He left the meeting right away. He went into Masjid Nabawi. He told his wife to come and tied himself to a pillar and said that until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives me, that I won't leave this pillar. Okay, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives me, that I will not leave this pillar. And the Prophet came to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said that if you would only come to me, I would have forgiven you. And I would have asked Allah for your forgiveness, but because you said that until Allah forgives me, there's nothing I can do, you'd have to wait. And he stayed that way. For any number of days, he stayed that way. And basically, except for salah and having to go to the bathroom, he would be tied. His wife would come, untie him at fajr time, he would pray the salah, she would tie him up again when he needed to go to the bathroom, at dhuhr time, that's it. Otherwise, he was tied to this pillar. So finally, after 25 days, and remember again, the Muslims are basically living in tents after how many weeks and weeks and weeks of difficulty. So after 25 days, the Banu Qurayza agrees that they're going to surrender. Obviously, they're hoping for clemency. They're hoping that would happen with Banu Nadir, right? This could happen with us. Now, the Prophet ﷺ has a little bit of a problem, politically speaking, because Banu Nadir was set free and allowed to go with everything except for their weapons. Before Islam entered Medina, the Aus and the Khazraj were allied with the different Jewish tribes. The Khazraj were allied with Banu Nadir, and the Aus were allied with Banu Qurayza. So if he is not lenient with Banu Qurayza, then the Khazraj may feel like, why is it that leniency was given here and not over here, right? So there could be, again, problems between the Aus and the Khazraj. So the Prophet ﷺ himself cannot decide this matter. So what he does instead is he goes to Banu Qurayza, and he says that, look, you know, before Islam came in here, your treaty was with the Aus, so I will put Sa'd bin Mu'ad. He will decide it. Do you agree? They said, of course we agree. He was their man before, right? He was their leader, essentially. So they said, of course we'll agree. So, now remember, Sa'd had been struck in one of the arteries with an arrow. So for all these days, right, 25 days of the siege, he was basically knocked out in the makeshift hospital in Medina. Again, barely can't doing much of anything. You're just basically waiting. If you haven't healed after 25 days, it's just you're just waiting for death, basically. So they get a donkey and they basically carry him up to where the Banu Qurayza are. And he comes, and when he comes, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the people, stand for your master, stand for your sayyid. Right? And this is where some of the ulama take the permissibility for standing up for people of your leaders or people of religious authority. So he tells them to stand up for your sayyid, for your master. Sa'd comes, and then again, he makes sure. The Prophet asks, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that are you agreed to this, right? And that's what you do, right? When there's a disagreement, you find somebody that both parties agree to. And the Prophet is happy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Sa'd, and are you? So they say again, yes, we agree. Whatever he says is fine. Whatever he says is fine. So Sa'd says that, look, you guys see the wound. You know what's happened to me. I know my days are limited. So I'm not going to be one of these people who worries about tribal affiliation, that, oh, the Khazraj had Banu Nadir and they had leniency. What if I'm not lenient? I don't have to worry about that anymore. I know where I'm headed within a matter of time. And so Sa'd basically says that all of the fighting men should be killed and everybody else will be taken captive. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he made this, that your judgment matched the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was actually what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had intended, and he used Sa'd bin Mu'ad as a way to bring this about. And this is actually the same punishment that was prescribed in the Jews' book itself. So if you look in the Old Testament, this is the punishment that they themselves mentioned for treason. And if you look anywhere, you look in American law, look in any time of fighting, The punishment for one is that you're treasonous when you're not in war. And for that, most countries will just put you in jail for the rest of your life. They won't kill you. But if you are treasonous during a time of war, the punishment is generally death. And there's different ways that in American society they used to do it. If you were from the poor class and you were a man, you'd be drawn and quartered. If you were a woman, you'd be burnt at the stake. And if you were from nobility, you'd have your head cut off. Right? This is how in America, I'm saying America and Britain, this was their code. Obviously now they've moved away from that, and if you're going to die, then it's what, by injection or whatever it is, right? But they still have this idea that during wartime, if you're treasonous, then death is the applicable punishment. So this also matched what was for them, and that's why they didn't make a fuss about it. I mean, they recognized, you know, that this is from our own law. They were the ones who agreed to Saad in the first place, and they knew that they were treacherous, and they were in the battle itself. In the midst of the battle, they were treasonous to the Prophet ﷺ. They ripped up the treaty that they had with him. And so all the fighting aged men, were executed. And then the women and the children were taken captive. There were some of the men who, before the decision came, had come out to accept Islam. They were accepted into the fold of Islam. Many of the women and the children over time were either freed because Islam recommends freeing the slave, or the people in Khaybar were able to ransom them. So many of the women and the children, some of them ended up accepting Islam as well. Just to read from the Old Testament. So it's in Deuteronomy. Before you attack a town that is far from your land, offer peace to the people who live there. If they surrender and open their town gates, they will become your slaves. Okay, so the bare minimum punishment is slavery for everybody. Okay, and that's if they agree to surrender. But if they reject your offer of peace and they try to fight, which is what Banu Qurayza already did in the battle, right? They rejected the peace, they broke up the contract, and they fought against the Muslims. And look at the one who's deciding, Sa'd bin Mu'adh, who died from what? Their treachery. Because of their treachery, he ended up getting the death blow dealt to him. So if they reject your offer of peace and try to fight, surround their town and attack. Then, after the Lord helps you capture it, kill all the men, take the women and children as slaves, and keep the livestock and everything else of value. Exactly what the Prophet ﷺ decided. But it continues. This is when you go to somebody else's land. What happens if you're in your own land? Where are the Muslims right now? They're in their own land. What happens if this happens in your own land? Whenever you capture towns in the land that the Lord your God is giving you, be sure to kill all the people and the animals. Khalas. Women, children, doesn't matter, fighting age, and all that. Just kill all of them. This is from their own book. Then kill them. He has commanded you to completely wipe out. And then it mentioned some tribes, I don't know, the Hittites and the Amorites and these different types of things. If you allow them to live, they will persuade you to worship their disgusting gods and you will be unfaithful to the Lord. And we saw with Banu Nadir, right? They were given clemency. How did this whole trench thing start? It wasn't the Quraysh who started it. It was, again, Huyay, coming from Banu Nadir when he was let go. So it's in line with their own way of doing things. Sa'd passes away a short time later, and the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the throne, the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shook when Sa'd passed away. And this happened for nobody else. And this shows how close he was to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what's amazing is 7 years. 7 years. Right? Sa'd is not one of the early Muslims from Mecca. 7 years he was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and look at what he built himself up to be. Right? I mean, he was already the leader of his people, but that was worthless until he became a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he did it in such a way that the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I mean, this enormous, we can't even fathom how large it is, this enormous structure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shook from the passing of Sa'd. I mean, this is how beloved to the Prophet as well, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was. And then after this, Abu Lubaba, finally the verses are revealed, one of the days after Fajr, it's about 20 days that he remained tied up, that he was forgiven. So Abu Lubaba is released. The Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Fajr goes and unties him and gives him the glad tidings. Just one last thing, you know, we had this big storm that came the last few days, and alhamdulillah, you know, this area I think was saved for the most part. And they're talking about the gas shortage, right, for fuel in New Jersey and New York area. And they mentioned any number of different gas stations that they had to call in the police, right, because fighting and all these different things happen. The true character of a person comes out when they're put in the pressure cooker. When times are tough, that is when you know who you are. And until that happens, you don't know who you are. You may think, like that Tabi'in said, if we had the Prophet ﷺ, his foot wouldn't touch the ground. No, you don't know. You think you know, but you don't know. And we should, for ourselves, we may feel like, no, subhanAllah, you know, how could I ever not believe in Allah, and how could I never not pray, and maybe somebody we know doesn't do this and that. until you're in that situation, you never know. And we see, I mean, look how people are reacting, that they're coming to blows and they're, right? Normally that person, probably that same guy who got in a fist fight is the guy in his office that they're like, that's the nicest guy in the world. You know, I've worked with him for 10 years, right? But when you're put in that situation, and I guarantee you, if you ask those people, there would have been one of two reasons they gave you why they started fighting. One, that guy cut in line, injustice. I'm not doing it for myself, but there has to be rule of law, there has to be justice, or my kids. You know, my wife is pregnant, you know, my kids, I have a 3-year-old at home, it's so cold, it's so this, it's so that. These are probably one of the two reasons, right? These are the typical excuses that we sort of sometimes give, right? So when you're put in that pressure cooker, and what you see with the Sahaba, they lived it. I mean, for those from the beginning, 13 years and now 5 more years, this was a pressure cooker. And look at how they reacted. Yes, they were people, they were hungry, nobody raised their hand when the volunteer was asked for, but they never backtracked from the true nature of Islam, the character that comes in the believer. And that's what we should really be striving for, and that's what we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He instill in us that true iman, that tawakkul, and that true character of a Muslim. Wa akhiru da'wana, and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.